Every death that occurs from an asbestos exposure could be prevented.
Don't be fooled. There is a connection.
Everything just ties together.
I don't know what I can do.
It's hard to describe what ADAO has been in my life. I certainly can't imagine it without ADAO.
We've come a long way, and I'm really proud of ADAO.
Keep me in your heart for
once again, Linda's asked us folks from Montana to come down and speak a little bit about things in Montana, since we do them differently and we see funny things there also. Large creatures, Bigfoot, a few things like that. So anyway, we'd like to start out here and show you, this is our backdrop where we screen for asbestos. It seems like a very unlikely setting, as you might have already guessed. There we go. I did want to go backdrop here a little bit and catch you up. Last year, when we were here, we were in the process of breaking ground and building on to our facility in Libby. And this is a picture with our Senator Baucus, who helped bring money to create our expansion. And this is what we looked like before. And this is what we're looking like now. So, and this is very close to completion. We're moving into some of the new areas of the building this last week or so. And so it's a relief for everybody, including patient staff all the way through, but now we can accommodate a much larger crowd. And so we're very excited. So let me talk to you about screening. That's one thing that we have this opportunity to basically continue an ongoing screening process. This is a skill that I gained a great deal of experience in working on when we started with developing the initial screening program that was spearheaded by the ATSDR in 1999-2000 and in collaboration with the EPA. And myself as a Lincoln County Health Officer in Montana. And so I learned a lot about screening in this process. And then during this screening, of course, in those 2 years, 2000, 2001, we screened 7,300 individuals, more than 18% were BRED positive. There was utilization of two readers of x-rays that had to be in agreement to create a positive. And then there was a third reader who would then be utilized if there was a disagreement between the two. And you can see that's a prevalence of pleural changes of 18% or over. It certainly puts this above the usual population and certainly in the category of an occupationally exposed group. And out of this screening, when there were disagreements by B readers and there was a third reader and then only one out of three thought there might be a asbestos-related abnormality, there was a selection of participants that had this criteria, and they were offered the opportunity to participate in a CT scan study also carried out by the ATSDR. And you'll see on that, out of the 353 participants, 27% of those that were equivocal in their chest x-ray findings were considered positive for asbestos-related disease. So when you look at the scope of our problem, or our potential problem, you can see that it goes way beyond 7,000, probably during the life of the mine from 1923 to 1990, that is a zonalite mine on Vermiculite Mountain, about 80,000 people resided in the area. The majority of these came there after 1950, and certainly that puts it over 55,000 individuals who were placed at risk from their exposures. Now, what are the other factors that we bring forth when we're screening this population? Well, one thing we did know was this is not your usual environmentally exposed population, in that we'd already witnessed and observed the significant asbestos-related disease and even death in that population that was environmentally exposed. We were dealing with exposure to a relatively unstudied amphibole mixture, and we observed that increased fiber potency, that is, it seemed to be very lighter, much lighter exposures were leading to rather advanced fibrotic disease. We also noted a varied pattern in the health effects, that is, the scarring pattern that we saw was predominantly pleural, and we did not see much in the way of interstitial disease, and the disease advanced basically in a more of a pleural progressive disease. And of course, there's the public health concerns in this process of screening. It was very important to understand libby-amphibole toxicity and how were we going to do that without some sensitive way to try to determine how many people were affected and what their exposures were to try to get garner a better understanding of dose response. So in Libby, it's a poorly recognized disease because of the fact that it hugs the chest wall. It's predominantly pleural scarring. That's true whether you got exposed as a zone light worker for 20 years or somebody that lived in a household or some child that played in the ore piles. The pattern that you see is primarily pleural fibrosis. Interstitial fibrosis is basically a little bit of background, perhaps, just an average population. But it's frequently was not recognized because the scarring was very thin, it's diffuse, and it paralleled the chest wall, and it was non-calcified, very difficult to pick out on radiographic shadows. And once again, now plaques in our population, which we always have in the past have been considered beauty marks, are a indicator of significant exposure and the risk for progressive asbestos-related disease. And I'll show you a case that shows what happens in some of these. Now, once again, diffuse pleural thickening, normally it's about equal probably with plaques in terms of its prevalence in the populations, but in our population it seems to be very much predominant. So how do we start looking for this? We need a sensitive way to find this pleural fibrosis. And with chest x-ray study, we know that there's standardized reading methodology with ILO system. However, I think we're all aware that it lacks sensitivity and specificity. It's been shown through autopsy studies that in some studies where autopsies were done, the sensitivity may be as good as 28% or 30%, so it can miss a significant number of plaques depending on where they're located in the chest, but there's frequently false negative findings. The oblique views improve the sensitivity, however they're not part of the ILO system. So chest CT obviously has been a much better tool to as far as sensitivity and specificity for picking up asbestos-related changes and better characterizes what's going on in the chest. Its real deficiency is it lacks standardized reading methodology, and that became very evident in the ATSCR screening in 2001, where we had multiple readers on CTs. And I had this idea that somehow it would be the gold standard, and I realized, nope, there's not a gold standard. And that's yet to be developed. And that's some of the things we are working on currently in some of our projects. So anyway, here's an x-ray. I don't know how that projects. I can't tell from here. But anyway, this is just an x-ray to show you that, you know, if you're just doing a B-read on this x-ray, some people might say there's some abnormalities there. But really, if you look on the standard method to try to look at the pleural thickening and profile, it's really hard to say you see anything in profile. Some people may argue that there's something on FOSS there. But really, it could be missed by a number of B readers. And the reason for that is simply that you can see with the front of the chest upward, there's plaques. And do I have something to point? Guess not. Well, there. Yeah. The plaques, right? There's plaques in front of the chest here and some pleural thickening in the back of the chest. But once again, on the sides, which would show on the x-rays, there's absolutely nothing showing there. There. Now, the next slide, you'll see in the back of the chest, there's very prominent pleural scarring and fibroadalactatic changes around the atelectasis. Once again, on the sides of the chest, where you would normally see a pleural thickening on x-ray, you don't see it here, and that's why it's hiding in the back of the chest and in the front. And so that's how you can miss things so easily doing B-reads and have a very significant asbestos-related disease in the chest. So screening radiography, we know we can detect diffuse pleural thickening. It's definitely improved with the CT studies, but once again, lack of agreement on recognition of the diffuse pleural thickening and no B-read standards for the HRCT. And the reason, once again, is this thickening in our population involves the parietal pleura, which is not typically what you read in the literature, which usually states that diffuse pleural changes are usually associated with pleural effusions and visceral pleural fibrosis. What we see on our thoracoscopies is it's a sheet of fibrous coating over the entire parietal pleura. It's thin, usually less than 5 millimeters in thickness. And once again, lamellar, where it parallels the chest in a very smooth fashion and predominantly non-calcified. Very difficult for folks to sort these out. So, and this is what it looks like. You can see a little piece of the thin membranous, the fibrous, fibromembranous tissue that's been taken off the chest wall there. And that's that thin layer. And you can see that how if it laid against the chest wall, well, it'd be hard for imaging to pick that up. And here's what it looks like. And once again, I don't know how easy that is for everybody to see, but I threw a little calcification in up at the front here on the left, just to show you that, yeah. But the rest of this, there's a layer that sits between the rib and the lung on both sides. And that's the typical pattern. When you look inside, it looks here, these get either ignored, these shadows get ignored, or they're called extrapleural fat. When you go inside and look at the chest wall, we've done that in several of these, and they have a sheet of white inside their chest, against the chest wall. So this is just another one, same thing, that runs along the real thin layer that runs along the chest walls with here's a little calcification in the back here. But along both chest walls, there's a very thin layer that surrounds the lungs. So is environmental exposure to living amphibole a problem? And I mentioned something to you about that, but here's a typical activity of in Libby, playing in ore piles and playing around the material. And here's a young man that didn't even live in Libby. He lived 70 miles to the west, but he lived along the railroad track where the ore spilled out, and he played with that, took it home and popped it. And they left the Troy area at 18 and started having problems in his 30s, and now you've seen him at about 45 here, where you can see his whole left chest is basically, his left lung is trapped, and there's very little aerated lung on this side, and there's a total shift of his of the mediastinal structures to the left. He's obviously got pleural thickening that goes down the chest on the other side also, but at 45, he experiences very severe chest discomfort, and he's had a very progressive pattern of his disease simply from playing. So what do we do on screening? Well, we have exposure criteria by law for eligibility, and that means living and live, work or play in the Libby area, actually Lincoln County now, but for 6 months or more, at least 10 years prior to the point of desiring screening. And we have a questionnaire. We get information on exposure, smoking history, and respiratory symptoms. And we do a PHS film as well as a pulmonary function test. Now, when there's equivocal or normal chest film but significant exposure and symptoms, we offer a chest CT to better evaluate based on our experiences with x-ray and its failure to pick up further significant asbestos-induced disease. And if we do get a positive chest film, but haven't have an abnormal lung function, especially with a low DLCO suggesting parenchymal injury, we proceed ahead with a chest CT to better characterize their lung disease. Now, what about other health effects of interest? I'm going to just present another case just with the manifest much of what we talk about and see. And here's another childhood exposure, 55-year-old who grew up in Libby, played in the ore piles frequently, was a very active young man, and even up into his adult years was hiking and running regularly. It was evaluated in year 2000 because he was having some problems with breathing and was diagnosed with asthma. And he did have a few plaques in his chest. And if you can see those, there's just a few plaques in his upper left chest, and that's it. But at the time that he showed up in 2004, his x-ray looked just like this, and he'd already quit running. He was having a lot of problems, including chest discomfort. And it wasn't much longer, and in 2 years, he went to an x-ray that looked like this. And I don't know if you can see it there. There is some real subtle pearl thickening now developing in his along the, in profile on his chest walls, and but had severe chest pain. And some of this is he just could not take a deep inspiration, but also has some interstitial changes within that too. But anyway, he had a very rapid course from 2004. He just died last year, 2010, of end-stage lung disease. And and the pain that he had was quite severe. He was on high doses of narcotic throughout this. The pleural pain was intense. And so this is a pattern that we don't understand yet. But this is kind of the way he looked. He just went downhill like this. So, and you can see by 2006, he really couldn't muster a pulmonary function test. He hurt so bad in the chest, and really his forced vital capacity had dropped off considerably. So we are observing something different here, we feel. And why do they have such intense pain with their fibrosis? What mechanisms are associated with rapid progression? And could autoimmune mechanisms play a role? There's limited studies looking at these anti-nuclear antibodies and their association with asbestos exposure. There are two studies, however, that relate presence of ANAs and the Libby amphibole exposure. And these were done at University of Montana. The first one was led by Gene Fowle, where they looked at levels of ANA and extracted nuclear antigen in the Libby population with asbestos disease and compared it to a control population from Missoula, Montana, who were not exposed. And clearly there was a significant increased prevalence of elevated antibodies in the Libby population. It was something like 20 to 30% higher. In a second study, they looked at the reporting of autoimmune diseases in the Libby screen population, and the odds ratios for systemic autoimmune diseases was something of the order of 2.15, and for rheumatoid arthritis, the odds ratio was over 3. So there were here further indicators that suggest that. There is some association going on and it needs a further look. So anyway, the hypothesis now sitting out in front of us is Libby amphibole is an environmental trigger for development of SAIDs and also other autoimmune phenomena I should have put on there. Now the question comes up then, could the characteristics of rapid progression and intense pruritus be related to an autoimmune mechanism? And currently, we are working with Steve Levan at Mount Sinai. We're doing working on a CDC grant, and our interests are to do comparative studies looking at the Libby population exposed to Libby amphibole with that of the Mount Sinai insulators who had heavy occupational exposure. And we're looking at autoimmune antibodies, we're looking at anti-mesothelial antibodies, and then we're looking at rate of disease progression, and we're using a lower exposed group compared to a very heavily exposed occupationally exposed group, and so we're several years into that now, and we'll be drawing autoimmune antibodies on all these participants and. And we'll be comparing them across these different fiber types. So anyway, I'm going to end with this. This is the picture that's always worth talking about because it's actually one of those pictures that's got a lot of hidden faces. And that's like screening. If you got to know what you're looking for or you may not find it. And so it's really easy in these situations with x-rays to, if you don't know what you're looking for, to miss it. And so it's always worth remembering that also. So anyway, that ends things, and thank you.
But thanks for coming, and thanks for making this the most successful conference thus far.
Keep me in your heart.